need to work. We said, okay, if you buy the computer, we need to network it together. So we also set up a networking company. So we started selling the computers and doing the networking. And then about 2007, I had gone off to go and set up my own company, actually, the software company. I'll tell you the story another day. But in 2007, we brought all the companies together under Computer Warehouse Group. So now we could give you your hardware, we could give you your network, and we could give you your software. So we are the one-stop shop. Down the line, we got big customers. We started selling banking applications. Got all the first banks of the world as customers. We even got MTN as a customer. But one of the critical businesses that we did was with Ashaka Cement. Ashaka Cement was in Ashaka, in Bauchi State. And they had a computer they bought from Dell in the US. And then the computer spoiled. The computer was being used by the wife of the MD. So of course, you can know what happens when the wife of the MD's computer spoils. The MD didn't sleep, the head of IT didn't sleep, but there was nobody who could repair it. Somebody gave them our number, they called us, and we just said yes. We didn't even want to finish hearing what was the problem. But our trick was simple. We just went and bought a new computer, because we know we're not going to be able to fix it there. It took us 2 days to find where Ashaka was, put the computer there, took the old one, and from there we got so much business that we became the Dell partner in Nigeria. We moved ahead. That by 2008-2009, we were able to get a private equity firm to come and invest in us. I won't tell you all the trouble, but we're able to do it. We're able to actually raise finance, significant finance. And since then, we've become ISO certified. Somebody was talking about SON, and I can tell you the stories too. We have gone to the point where people have got to write case studies about us to see what we have done, how we have done it. So we've gone from being the man who sells you just the computers, the computers from the networks, my friend Christine, enterprises, can do the same. From computers to the networks, to the software, to the training, we've done all the corporates, we are doing services, and we're now at the point where we're actually providing services for SMEs like you. I'm not going to talk about that solution that much, except to say that if you want to sell online and you want to sell under your own brand, if you go outside, our stand is there, you can just open it now and you can start. If you're also worried about how you track your sales across multiple shops or multiple locations, we also have a solution that possible for you to do it at the lowest price. But that's not why I'm here. So let's look at some 10 lessons. We've learned a lot. I mean, when we started, I had afro hair. No, seriously, I had afro hair. But now, my son asked me what happened. I said, well, each time you cost me trouble, I lose one hair. So you can see the number of troubles you cost. Number one, branding. If you look at my jacket, I have my logo here. Let me ask, how many people here have a logo pin?
Here.
Okay. How many people have a branded shirt?
I have
off here.
That you're wearing? A branded scarf. You see, in the final analysis, what is going to survive is your brand. Your brand, with your brand, you can appear bigger than what you actually are. Especially in this current age of e-commerce, As they say, nobody knows on the internet whether the man behind it, whether the thing behind it is a dog. Nobody knows. He has not seen you. It is how you project your brand and what you use to support your brand that is going to add so much value. Those are the things you can't value. Nobody can touch it. And you have to spend energy and time to build that brand. And part of building that brand is making sure you deliver on your promises, going the extra mile, but also making sure that people know that you're doing business. If not, you have a problem. So if you are not building your brand today, start. Maybe it's just a face cap that you always wear. Somebody said Warren Buffett has a big investment in Coca-Cola. And you know what? He doesn't drink wine. He's always drinking Coke. The other thing we learned is that if the journey is far, you get there very quickly with less stress if you are working with somebody else. If it's only you, your head will break. In our company, we had somebody who was very good with marketing and branding. We had somebody who is very good with technology. We had somebody who is very good with operations of the company. And we've been together for the past 22, 23 years. So if you're doing this business and you don't have people who are going to compliment you, look again. It's important. And that partnership is not just people who compliment you. It's also companies that will compliment you. I'll give you an example. Today, there are things we're doing. And we're going out and trying to create franchises. It's for free. Even if you want to become our franchisee, we'll sign you up. We'll train you. We'll provide you materials. We'll provide you support. We'll even direct customers to you. Because the more you are, the bigger the cake you can pay. If you are not doing a lot of partnerships, you'll find that you'll be an SME for a very, very long time. The other things we learned is that as quickly as possible, you need to be able to define the process that you have. That is what is going to be able to allow you bringing people up the street, and they will start becoming profitable for you. They start becoming productive for you. If you alone have the knowledge of how this thing is done in your head, you will not be able to grow. I have a friend who is trying to make soap. And only him knows the formula for the soap in his head. Only him knows the process for producing the soap. And I told him, if Procter & Gamble was doing that, how many soap do you think they will be broken? And he said, no, he doesn't want anybody to steal
this technology.
You have to define those processes. If you have something you think is worth protecting, please go to the patent office and go and protect it. You won't protect it by keeping it in your head only. The other thing we learned was governance. And it starts from very simple things. The business funds, the money that your business owns, is not your money. It's the money of the business. Your money is your money. You can be paid dividend, you can be paid salary, whatever. But let your money, and let the company's money be the company's money. You have to have governance so that people can also pull you back. As I would say, if you have a powerful CEO, he can easily drag the company down by taking the wrong decisions because nobody can challenge you. You need somebody to challenge you. For many of us, it's our spouse. I mean, I'll come back, tell my wife, this happened. I say, look at this, a load of money. So it doesn't occur to me. I say, how do you know this? He say, well, I go to market every day and I buy things. Can't you see this? Well, it's important that you have that governance so that says, this is how our company works. These are the checks and balances. If you have salespeople, for instance, you'll be surprised that some of them will go out and say they're going to sell your product. But they're actually selling their own product, or they are going to play drafts somewhere. You'll find that if you're going to grow, what we learned is the value of transparency. In your partnerships, in your branding, transparency is important. Because people need to believe you when you're telling them the truth. Because many of the things we have is not that we're telling a lie. is that you're telling the truth and somebody doesn't believe you that you're telling the truth. So when you prepare your account and you give it to the bank doesn't believe that those accounts are really what they should be. So what are you going to do? From early in your business, you have to resolve to keep accurate records. We do have solutions that can help you, but you can keep your records on paper. Some people will run away and say they will not prepare their P&L because they don't want government to tax them. But you know what? If your secretary or your friend or whoever helps you to prepare fake results, fake financial statements, so that you can dodge paying tax, you know that that friend can also prepare the same fake results, fake financial statements, so that he can cheat you. How will you know the difference? You won't know the difference. Now, you must also evolve, or as they say these days, pivot.
What?
Pivot. Twist around.
Pivot.
Turn around.
Pivot.
Because there's no one way to the end of this journey. In fact, there is no end to the journey. The journey itself is the reward. Like I said, we started from doing selling hardware. In fact, we started selling Dell. Everybody knows about Dell. I can tell you today, if you come to us and say you want to buy a Dell computer, we are going to scratch our head and send you somewhere else. And if you remember that a company like Nokia at one time was making paper, was a forestry product, a forestry company, and they started making mobile phones, became the world's largest mobile phone maker. Don't assume, I know, some people preach, you put your focus, you have your passion, you put your head to it, and make sure I agree. But what you need to do is that sometimes what you think is the value you are providing is not the value you are providing. You have to step back and look at it. What do people really want? What is it really that I can sell? And try to provide those. I like the people who have come as mutual, I'm an aspiring. I've got the land. I'm just trying to figure out how to do it. But you see, what I also found is that while cultivating the land is very good, a lot of people make money from just moving that product from where it's cultivated to the man who will buy it. So sometimes you think that being a farmer is for you to cultivate the product. But it might be that your real business is just finding those products, packaging it, and taking it to the people who will buy. So you should be ready to evolve as the business changes, as the economy changes, as PDP becomes APC. And that's evolution, not evolution. And please, do have a plan. In our company, what we learned after about 5 years was that we need to have a plan. So we start having 5-year plans. Not 1 year, not two. We start with a 5-year plan, and then we break that 5-year plan into yearly plans. We are not cast in stone. We might switch around. But because we had that plan, it sort of set us on a certain path. When we had a plan for listing, we didn't plan to list on Nigerian Stock Exchange. We said we are going to list on NASDAQ in the US. Big dream. But it forced us to do a lot of things that when we wanted to list on the Nigerian Stock Exchange, even the stock exchange said they've never seen a company this prepared for listing. Because for like 5-10 years, we've been running as if we're a public company. So when we came and they say, oh, you need 5-year results, we say 5, we have 10. So you need to have a plan. If you don't have a plan, it will be tough. Another thing is corporatize. I'll explain what I mean. Let your company run as if it's a large corporation. It doesn't mean you're going to have lots of people. It means processes. It means having certain kinds of reports, having certain kinds of management decisions, having a way to do it. It doesn't mean you'll be locked into it. You leave yourself the flexibility as a growing company to adapt, evolve. But you have to let people see that it's a big company. If you want to be bigger than Procter & Gamble. You have to think like Procter & Gamble and act like Procter & Gamble. That's really how it works. At least that's what we've learned in our 23 years. And one other thing that has stood us out from the beginning is that it's our customers first. It's not about whether we want to sell a product. It's not about whether we want to make money. We do want to make money, definitely. It's about the customer first. What does he want? What is his pain? Sometimes it's totally outside your business. In fact, it can be so out of your business that you start another business. I'll give you an example. We started selling ATMs. And people were putting ATMs in off-site locations. They would come to a hotel, they would go to airport, you can't put an ATM. And the problem is that the ATM requires that you have power. So, before we know it, we went from advising them on how to put power to actually starting to supply them with inverters. And from supplying them to inverters to, okay, maintaining the inverters, to monitoring the inverters. And then it became a significant other business. It was never part of our plan. But by looking at the customer, not only will you build your brand and your business, you will create new areas of growth for yourself. And I think this is the last one, so I don't bore you too much. You have to use technology. And this is the best time to use technology. This is the time that technology has actually become really affordable. When I was working in Inlax, when I was living in Inlax, if you needed 10 people to carry a 10 megabyte hard disk, because it was big, bulky, expensive. Today you're carrying phones around, and those phones are carrying 1 gigabyte, 16 gigabytes.
32 gigabytes, 64.
Just check, look at the difference. Today you have close to 60 million Nigerians, 114 million phone numbers in Nigeria. We are trying to help the people who are on our platform, our e-commerce platform. And then we have a database of 2 million phone numbers. So we said, okay, let's try something. Over a weekend, we'll just send out SMS telling people, okay, go to Randa Pluto, she has clothes. Go to this one, he has phones. Go to this one, he has phones. You know what happened? Some of those shop owners started calling us. I say, what happened? No, they were asking, what? Something seems to have happened. We say, what? See, they're getting calls. Everybody is asking them, okay, where is this it has not. We said, okay, fine. We just did a small promotion for you. What I'm saying is, these things are there. How many people are on WhatsApp? How many people have sent a picture of what they are selling on WhatsApp? They're very smart people here. But what I'm saying is, you have to use technology to push your business. Now, you don't have to be in one location. You can stay in one location and be visible in many, many locations. You can stay in one location and be able to track what's happening in multiple shops that you own. If you want to expand, you don't have to go and buy a physical shop, a physical facility. You need to also learn how to use technology to your advantage. The Google people are around, but Google is a very good friend. If you are looking for somebody to help you make something, go to Google, you'll find it. And of course, who is on Facebook? Well, how many people have advertised what they're doing on Facebook? Okay, so a lot of people are on Facebook, but very few people have wanted to use Facebook to drive business. I'm just looking at the IT side of it. But obviously, if you've been to field, you know that there's technology for everything. In fact, I told them that I'll come because I want to start bottling palm wine. In my area, we make very good palm wine. So we came back to the, and I like palm wine. You know, normally I get the fresh one, fresh off the. Then I came to Lagos and I said, I saw palm wine, bottled palm wine. And I made the mistake of buying it. I'll say it's a mistake because when I poured it into the bottle, even my